I get a PCR result and they tell me CT36 and they tell me it is a low viral load. I mean, high number, low viral load, what does it make sense of? Stay tuned with us, watch this YouTube channel because we're going to explain the highs and lows of PCR all to you. Hi, I'm Dr. Leong Hoe Nam. This is another episode of Making Science Simple and Relevant for Everyone. I'm an infectious disease physician, and our purpose is just to educate you and make things easily understood. Today's topic is quite simple. It's about COVID-19. It's about PCR or polymerase chain reaction. We want to help you understand how PCR works, why you can get a false positive, and why you can get a false negative. The topics for discussion today will come next. Today's topics for discussion is actually quite simple. What is a PCR? And to put it very simply, PCR is an echo chamber. You know, echo chambers tend to amplify the very soft voice of one individual. You keep saying it over and over and over again. Very soon you can hear it and you can pick it up, detection. And that's what PCR is designed for, to pick up rare sequences. We're going to talk a little bit about cycle threshold. CT, cycle threshold, or threshold cycle. What does it mean and what does it represent? I'm going to talk about what's false positive and what's false negative. We're going to go into explanation as to why it happens. Stay tuned. PCR stands for polymerase chain reaction. And you see the word chain reaction, you remember a nuclear reaction. A simple start and you end up with a huge explosion that's visible everywhere. In other words, you are detecting small rare things and you amplify it many, many times and you see it big and good, easier to detect. So the easiest way to understand PCR is actually to imagine that you're looking for a rare book. In a rare book, you could go through many, many bookstores from 5, 10, 15, 20, even 40 bookstores before you find it. You thus realize that the earlier you can find the book, the less rare it is. If you need to go to 40 bookshops to find them, then it's going to be a very rare book. So the number of searches in turn will determine how rare the book is. The more searches, the rarer the book. Or the other way of looking at it, the high search count means lower probability of finding the book. This is a classic picture of what PCR reactions is. You will see the DNA and then there's temperature changes and you see the separation of the nucleic acids. Well, the search for this book happens with a gene probe. The gene probe is the one that will do the active searching and when it finds a matching sample, it will bind to it. When it binds to it, it will amplify it and separate. You see, find, amplify, separate. Go through a cycle, find, amplify, separate, find, amplify, separate. And after 40 cycles, you have a doubling 2 to the power of 40 times, which ends up with a very large figure. And the item of gene of concern becomes detectable. So you get amplified upon amplified upon amplified, and you have it amplified more than 1,000 times. Makes it much easier to spot it. And that's the beauty of polymerase chain reaction. Rare things, but you let the gene probe look for it. And I've said it before, it's like an echo chamber. A small sound is repeated many, many, many times and it becomes a loud sound inside a chamber and you can detect it. So the temperature changes you see from 96, 50 to 72 degrees is used to change the gene probe. Whether you attach, amplify, or separate. So the rapid changes in temperature are needed as part of PCR. As you amplify, you end up accumulating more and more of your target of interest. It accumulates and you can try to measure it and you see the levels going up. At a certain threshold, it becomes detectable or what they call significant. At that threshold, at that cycle number, it's called the cycle threshold or the CT. So you can imagine immediately, if you have a high viral load, you would expect the CT to be very early because it's like a not so rare book, you find it earlier in the bookstores. But if it's something very, very rare and very, very few copies, you expect to find it much later at the end of 30, 40 searches in the stores. You would expect a higher CT value. So the CT numbers would then in turn inform you how much virus there is. The CT cycle threshold, again, is the cycle at which you detect the target. The analogy again, CT is the X number of searches which you have to conduct before you find a rare book. Smaller number, easier to find, means they are less rare. There's more copies of it. If you have a big CT number, that means you went through many bookstores to find it, that means it's quite a rare book. It was quite difficult. So a high number of searches represents lower probability. High searches means lower probability of finding a book, which in turn you can actually translate it as higher CT means lower viral load. Conversely, if you have a lower CT, you will have a higher viral load. Simple, isn't it? False positives, what are they? These are situations where the test comes out positive, but in truth, the person doesn't have the illness at all. It's not a real positive, it is a false positive. False positive does happen at about 1% of the time. 1% seems small, but if you think about it, if you have 1 million tests which are running every day, 1% error means 10,000 samples are wrong. That's a lot of inconvenience to a lot of people. Why do false positives turn up? Well, it's usually because of contamination. The contamination could happen after the sampling, as it goes through a certain process, the samples get things put inside accidentally, or it can be within the laboratory itself. And the best way to solve the problem is to repeat the test. There are some typical features of a false positive result. The CT is usually quite high, usually in the region of 35 to 37 or 38. So hard to detect, they're kind of very rare because contaminations are much rarer. What about false negatives? False negatives are the converse of false positives. The test turns out negative when the person actually has the disease. Again, it happens, but it happens a little bit more frequently, about 3 to 5%. Now, in this situation, we tend not to blame the lab because it is often a sampling error. If you look for virus in the wrong places, you're going to have a false negative. Not that it wasn't there, but the virus is somewhere else in the body and you went looking at the wrong place, literally knocking at the wrong door, getting the wrong answer. Sometimes the person who collects it, you do a bad job of it. You don't go there, do a good collection, you end up with a lousy result. And what I like to call rubbish in, rubbish out. You have a rubbish sample that's given, you're going to get a rubbish result. Wrong sample, there's a mix-up in sample, or poor transportation. The RNA which you're dealing with are very fragile to temperatures. Fluctuations, too hot, can actually destroy the RNA. Poor handling, again, can destroy the RNA. So we need to be very careful in the entire passage of the sample from the collection right down to the laboratory. That way, we can minimize false negatives. Now, this is just a simple slide to show you one simple way in which false negatives can occur. The money is at the back of the nose, or rather, the virus is at the back of the nose. If you do a nasal swab like this, you are only going to sample the anterior part of the nose. If you do it deep inside, you're going to find it at the back. And where is the virus? Where's the money? It's at the back of the nose. So the further you go in, the more likely you're going to end up with a good result. So many of the false negatives which we see, and I'm very sure you've heard of reports where the PCR is no longer good, it's coming out negative, negative, negative. That's not true. It's because the sampling technique was poor. Many people are very frightened of putting the test all the way to the back. Remember, the money or the virus is at the back of the nose. And remember, you have rubbish in as a sample, you have rubbish out as a result. This is the end of my slide. A short session today. Again, Rophi Clinic here, Dr. Leong Hoe Nam. We want to make science simple and relevant for everyone. Do click the subscribe button and we will keep you informed of any new YouTube videos that come along to educate. And you may have more questions on your own or you want to seek further clarifications, drop us a message under the comment section and we'll be glad to help you. Again, until the next time, see ya!